I think for most young people who are idealistic, who want to do something, who go to university, they face probably the most hostile learning environment in the world. I think one of the jobs of university administrators and professors and lecturers is to put as many obstacles to learning as far as possible. And the obstacles are all different types. The primary one is compulsory attendance. I think if you removed compulsory attendance from university, you would know how many people really want to listen to you or want to take up. If you want a ranking system, and do it for Harvard first, because according to all the reports, documented reports on Harvard, they have one of their worst departments is their undergraduate department. They don't do any undergraduate teaching at all. As a matter of fact, many universities do far better undergraduate teaching than Harvard. And that would be a good way to bring Harvard down at least, 300 points on the ranking system. But they don't do that. But what I'm trying to say is that when students come to a university, and at least they're hoping that university and college is not going to be like the 10 years of imprisonment that they faced in school, where they had to sit on wooden benches for nearly 5 to 6 hours. And these are children whose natural instinct and endowed by nature to actually move around, play games, climb trees, and you take them and put them in this monkey box and make them sit there for 10 years. And after 10 years, they think that they are going to go into a great new world where they will be free, they will be able to wear their own clothes, they won't have to wear a uniform. And where do they end up? In further benches, tied down for another 4 years, if they're doing a PhD for, I think, another 8 or 10 years, and I think only a fool would go through such a system. And all those guys who normally, say that this is insane and who get out of the system, they call them dropouts, but actually politically astute guys who are really walkouts. Anybody who had got some sense in his head would have walked out of university long time back. Children can't do it because they are totally dependent on their parents, and their parents will beat the hell out of them if they don't go to school. But to find grown-up people sitting for several hours listening to the same guy for sometimes 2 to 3 years, repeating the same stuff which has gone on for the last 30 to 40 years, not unchanged at all, it beats me. I mean, I don't consider university people in that sense as, you can walk out in the streets and in Bombay or in Goa or any other place, and every person is interesting except a university guy. I went once, I used to go to Goa University to give these lectures to students. And the lectures that the students shut me up saying that you want to talk about other things. We are not interested in listening to what you've got to say. You please tell us only and speak only to the syllabus. And after that, I stopped going. I said, this is not a place for normal human beings to be. And it's because we are in this world, we move along, as I said, incestuous sort of relationship. And we have professors in the staff room, or we are, in these dominant relationships with students. And people treat us well because we go to university and we look very polished and things like that. We have begun to feel that we are very important people. But in terms of the contribution to society, as I said, Professor Shadrock was saying yesterday, our contribution is not just zero, it's negative. It's negative. We're teaching people the wrong things. We're teaching them the wrong way. And we're giving them all the wrong messages. We're telling them that if you want to do some learning, you've got to go to this great institution. And most of us get frightened to even enter there because so much of money has been spent on these buildings and making them look avant-garde and the latest in terms of the conceptions of these lurid architects. And, sometimes in some universities, you don't know how to enter and how to get out, because the rooms are all designed in such funny ways and such passages and so on. You come to Goa University, you'll get stuck in there. You won't get out for 3 days. You need expert guidance. I'm talking about this environment, and how do you expect that learning could take place in this environment? And I think professors and the university lecturers know that no learning can take place in such environments. So they've reduced it. They themselves have reduced it. They said, we'll reduce it to very simple jobs. Read textbooks. And why do we read textbooks? Because we're not paid enough money, so we can write those textbooks and make some little extra money. And you read those textbooks. Don't go to the library. You read the textbook. We will examine you on whether you have able to regurgitate the textbook. And whole university education all over the world has been reduced to that. I mean, you reduce learning, higher learning is reduced to very low-down textbooks. Textbooks which are so badly written, because most university lecturers are not writers. They don't have a flair for writing. If they had flair for writing, they'd probably be writing novels and making some money there. They're very poor teachers. Nobody teaches. You know, the entire lecturing community in India is not taught how to present and make a point. They've gone to school, they've gone to college, then they get a degree, then they get recruited, and they're automatically standing in front of 50, 60 people and then telling them the truth. It's impossible. It's never going to happen. So what I've tried to do, at least in this paper, you won't find any quotations. I've got a history of revolting against quotations. I found most of my university colleagues spend half their time quoting other people, and we never get to hear what they have to say. The fundamental point is, why have we brought learning into this institution and kept it there, and now build all these sort of barriers to it so that people just can't get in? And why do we feel that higher learning is going to get, and it's only that higher learning which is of use to human beings? We know it's not of no use to human beings. In the traditional system, the traditional Indian system, you had to go to gurus. And you went to guru, sometimes it would be, I think it was a period of 12 years. Every 12 years, you had to stay with him. And the most interesting thing about these bloody gurus is they never told you anything. That's the point. If you are going to consider what somebody else is telling you as the truth, then it's no longer your truth. It's his truth, which you have made your own. So we have these endless stories in Indian culture where no guru ever tells you what exactly the whole business of life is about. He'll tell you, go and stay in a forest for 12 years, and you come back. And then you come back, he finds out from the way you are coming back, from the way you walk, whether you have found out anything. And then if he's convinced that you have not found out anything, he goes and tells you, go back again for another 12 years. Nowadays, we get a diploma in 3 months. But that sort of higher learning was completely free. And it was based on the person finding out for himself what the whole business of life was about, what meaning is about, what his place in the universe is about, what his role in society is about. And nobody was given a degree for it in any sense of the term, but it was relatively free. And I still can't figure out why in this whole society, for example, Malaysia, India, whatever, where we say people are yearning for learning, why we don't keep the doors of the universities free? Why do you charge fees? Why do you charge fees? Why do you have registration fees? Why do you have all this nonsense? If learning was always free, and if we are free societies, and we are all brothers and sisters, and we are part of one great family, why did we have this institution where from the beginning we start putting in all these blocks, and the first block being the block of cash? You don't have cash, sorry. You're not entitled for learning. Forget about higher learning. You're not entitled to learn. And we say we are modern societies. We have got unimaginable science, technology available to everybody in the world. Everything is available to everybody in the world. But you first pay the cash. Once you pay the cash, then it's over. Why can't we have a good university, maybe Pan-African university, where grandfathers, grandmothers, children, everybody is allowed to come and interact? If a professor can't talk to a grandmother and can't talk to a six-year-old child, what sort of a professor is this? What does he profess? In my scheme of things, if I were a vice chancellor, you know, I think they would have to remove most of these institutions from the planet. And literally, you know, open the doors. And why should we enable Vinay Lal to just yak to only 45 students in Delhi because they have to pay a cash to somebody so that they can pay him a salary? The entire city of Delhi can give him 1 rupee each and he would be a millionaire and he can talk to all of us. What's the use of his entire learning if it's stuck to 1,000 copies of a book and 40 students a year and he's got only 40 years of life and at the rate he's eating kebabs, he's going to go down faster. So I'm not going to be a vice chancellor because nobody's ever going to appoint me as a vice chancellor. But I thought that existing universities can do a lot of things. I've tried to propose them, you know, give them up in my presentation, which is a very chaotic presentation because I don't follow any academic rules and I'm not interested in following any academic rules. I've got no ranking to go through and nobody's going to bother about my career. But one of the things that Manish, I mean, he's a pal of mine, that's why I've dragged him up here, that we always say, why do you take students out from a learning environment and put them in a non-learning environment? Something that's I've never been able to understand. You take a child who is in a natural environment, who's learning continuously, and you say, now you stop that learning and we start this type of learning. And what's this type of learning? This type of learning is sit on a box and now we tell you what learning is. And they don't understand at all because they're not even mentally equipped to go through all that process. They're still wanting to do lots of other things. And then you say, no, now the learning, we decide what learning is and it's going to be every 30 minutes. And every 30 minutes, this child is learning history and enjoying history and then is going deeper and deeper into it and wants another 2 to 3 hours and say, no, now it's enough, stop that, start this new book, civics book. And after 20 to 30 minutes of civics book, they say, stop that learning, start this. So I can't understand how you can do this learning, start, stop. I mean, you know, how do you get anybody to learn anything like this? The whole university system is based on this. Now, we don't think that the university should be such that in one day, for example, one whole week is devoted only to history. So that everybody can discuss history, can discuss African history, what happened, whether we were part of Arabia or not, well, you know, what happened in India, what did the Buddha teach, and how long did he, you know, take his time to get his enlightenment, and all the questions that we wanted to ask. We have no concept as such. We think that everything has to be given in small doses, and those doses are sufficient, and of course, in the end, it never works. Why don't we have a whole year devoted to whatever we wanted to teach? And those who want to come, come. Those who don't want, go somewhere else. I don't understand the compulsion. Does anybody learn anything under compulsion? Does anybody anywhere learn anything under compulsion?